The art by Paul Fernandez, limited edition art by Paul Fernandez, is available at the festival bookstore for purchase. Bangalore Literature Festival 2016. Stories, poems, food, love, literature, erotica. We have all these for you. My name is Sangeet Varghese. I am the host for you for the day. When life itself seems lunatic, who knows where madness lies? Perhaps too practical is madness. To surrender to dreams might be madness. Too much of sanity might be madness. The maddest of all, to see life as it is and not what it should be. Don Quixote Today, Raghu Karnad in conversation with Ryan Lobo. Raghu Karnad is the editor at large at The Wire. He has worked as a reporter in Outlook and Thelka, and is a former editor of Time Out Delhi. He is the author of Father's Field, an account of India's Second World War. He studied political science at Oxford, and prizes won include European Commission's Lorenzo Natali Award. Ryan Lobo. Ryan Lobo is an award-winning filmmaker and photographer. Ryan is the founder of Opus CDM Ad Agency and Mad Monitor Productions. He has produced and shot more than 80 films on a variety of subjects, aired in channels like Nat Geo, Animal Planet, and Oprah Winfrey Show. His photographs and writings have been featured in several magazines and have been exhibited all over India. He is the author of the new book, Mr. Iyer Goes to War.
Thank you. Thank you all for being here. Thank you very much.
Hello.
So, could there be a better time to read this book, Mr. Iyer Goes to War? I don't think so. Could there be a better place to be launching it or introducing it? I kind of doubt it. Over here in the next stage at the Bangalore Lit Fest, we have two older Brahmin men, one of whom describes himself as driven by Devi's Shakti, protected by Hanuman, awakened by Shiva, serving the Dharma, and they're making their proclamations about how to return us to our ancient civilizational glory. And it seems to me that they could have been shaken out of one of the rough drafts of Ryan's book. In any event, in the final draft of Mr. Iyer Goes to War, the protagonist is Lalgudi Iyer. He's a Don Quixote for modern India, specifically modern Benares. A retiree, a Tambram retiree, who is also, or believes himself to be, a reincarnation of Bhima, and who sets off down the Ganga, questing to defend Dharma and defeat evil in whatever form he finds it, which includes evil contractors, Muslim construction men, and many, many others. The book is a wonderful piece of writing. It's like Kanishk's book, Kanishk just spoke. It's a novel that is going to return real energy and vitality to Indian fiction in a way that I think has been missing. It's a beautiful piece of farce. It's full of vigor and vitality and really, really razor sharp observations. So congratulations, Ryan, first of all.
Thank you, Raghu.
And above all, I think it's not just that you've written a very fine and interesting and appealing character. It feels to me that you've created an archetype for the present moment in India, when it seems that where the country is full of somewhat addled knights defending Vedic chivalry. So I want to begin by asking you what it was that drew you. You know, the parable of Don Quixote is one that has drawn various authors over the decades, over a very long period. So let's start at the beginning and ask what it was that drew you to this parable right now.
So Don Quixote is a character, an archetype, who lives by the values of a time gone by. And often with funny and sometimes disastrous results. But what drew me to this character was the fact that he keeps resurfacing. And no matter what happens, he rises from the ashes, so to speak. So I know various Don Quixotes in my own life, or people who might live by certain values which they feel might be reduced in these very in these changing times of ours, in these times where things are happening so fast that a lot of people might feel left behind. So what drew me to this character of Don Quixote and creating an Indian Don Quixote was the fact that I knew so many. And I found something quite epic in the often very ordinary lives of these people who I knew.
Perfect. So, you know, whenever the idea of an homage to Don Quixote comes up, my mind goes to a story that was written by Borges. I've forgotten what the story is called. But in this story, a writer who is devoted to Cervantes and believes that Don Quixote... And is devoted to Cervantes and believes that Don Quixote is the most perfect novel, decides that he will try to rewrite it and make it better. And so he sets aside the book and he pulls out his own drafting paper and he writes. And at the end of it, as in any Borges story, he realizes that he has rewritten Don Quixote word for word. So did you find that keeping such a powerful having such a powerful example to begin with, was it easy to strike out and adapt the archetype of Quixote in the way that you needed?
I remember something you said when you launched your book, Raghu, which is once it started, the act of writing led to wind filling the sails and things moved on their own accord. So very often I feel that sometimes I look back at this book and say, did I write it? You know, I mean, you look back at it in a bitter shock. But on another note, this archetype, like we say it is, of Don Quixote, this person who lived by the values of an older time rising, and civilizationally, a lot of people in our country believe India's arriving now, so to speak. Like, we've had the Mughals, we've had the Brits, we've had poverty, we've had corruption, so on and so forth. So there's this feeling in the air that, whether right or wrong, I don't know, but that we are arriving, that we're coming about as a civilization. So, for example, in the book, I chose Varanasi because, once again, it's a city very dear to the cultural geography of India, the center of it, which has been reduced, which has been invaded, conquered, but it rises. So something has survived. And the character of Don Quixote, in many regards, provided a solution, if you will. It was a character who had risen again in the form of this old, aging Brahmin man, maybe a little disgruntled and upset with life, who decides to flee from a home for the dying and discover his adventure on the Ganges.
Right. But what is also true about the character of Don Quixote, as it is of Mr. Iyer, is that he's deluded. You may disagree at what level, what sort of cosmic level he's deluded, but he is probably not really a reincarnation of Bhima. And when he leaps into the fray in order to defend Dharma, he's usually misunderstanding the very basic nature of reality. His head is in the mythic, but his feet are, unfortunately for him, very much in the modern world. That's also an essential part of what the character is experiencing.
Yeah. So if you look at the story, it's a very cruel story. You've got somebody who believes who has a belief system which does not necessarily correspond with the reality you exist within. So the consequences are often rather painful. But what's also interesting is that these belief systems, they rise and fall. So it remains suppressed, but it comes back up and again, and it goes down. It's like a dolphin, I mean, over time. And what goes around comes around. So in some regards, the character, if you will, of Don Quixote, this way of believing, it's here to stay. And it's just as much a part of our reality as is the real world, you know?
Okay. Now, one of the fascinating things about talking to you about a novel you've written is that you are not... being a writer is not your foremost identity, although you write a lot. People who know you as a public figure would usually know you as a filmmaker and a photographer. And I couldn't, as I was reading the novel, one of the things that really leaps out is the sort of richness of the visual detail. There's no laziness, and nothing is taken for granted in this novel as to what the world is composed of. And especially, this can be especially challenging when you're writing about India and particular parts of India, which are filled with the clutter and the kind of mess of stuff that accumulates because of India being India. And that's something that this novel really illuminates brilliantly. What is it like? Do you think that your background and your skills as a photographer and as essentially a visual practitioner are what's behind that element of your style in the novel?
Well, I spent a lot of time on the Ganges and at the Kumbh Mela, at the celebration of Holi in Vrindavan, making documentary films. For Oprah, actually, a few years ago. So during the process of this filmmaking, I mean, we were shooting all the most beautiful, spectacular stuff. We were shooting the sadhus run into the river with their marigolds flying off. We were shooting people throwing color. But beyond the spectacular, there were a lot of people, especially at the Kumbh, who had traveled great distances. So I remember seeing this very old couple from, I think, Trichy. And they're very old. They were in the 80s, and they had walked down to the river, and they had a bath. And they left, and when I got a chance to talk to them, they said they knew it was their last trip to the Ganges. So, and that their fathers had done this, their parents had done this, their parents' parents had done this, and for as long as they could remember. So there's something quite interesting about that. And whereas, while as a filmmaker, as a photographer, I was shooting what was outwardly quite spectacular, I found the epic nature of this visit by this old couple to be equally spectacular, but maybe not as visual. So in some ways that informed the novel, you could say.
That's true, that's very interesting. So tell me about your personal, I've never really read a contemporary Indian novel about Banaras. This is the first thing like that I've read, and it's a fantastic treatment. It's both, as I said earlier, beautifully detailed, but also very kind of genuinely expressed, and there are lines in it that I think will go down as being sort of as being really memorable lines about the city. One of them, that Banaras is poetry forced to be a city. There's a lot that's very rich in it and evocative about Banaras. So tell me about what the city actually meant to you. What your feelings are about a city that's as tumultuous, sometimes as frustrating and in strange ways so spiritual and yet so squalid.
Thank you, Raghu. That's quite a question. Personally, my experiences haven't always been good, to be frank with you, in Banaras and all these places. Because you go there expecting a certain place, a certain adventure, but it's usually quite dirty and everyone's trying to con you and you're being ripped off constantly, and then you fall in the Ganges and you're scared you'll get tuberculosis and things like that. But at the same time, I was there in the context of being a filmmaker, and I was shooting for companies like, say, National Geographic or clients in the US or PBS or people like that. And very often what I was looking at, what I was interviewing, the people I were interviewing, it was quite wonderful and informative, but I very often felt the real story had to come from people from Banaras themselves. And the city itself, you could take as a character, if you will. It's if you go on a boat along Banaras, and you can see the different layers, and it's almost like you're going back in time. And right on top, you have your Bauhaus construction. And as you go lower, you can see the older buildings and so on and so forth. And it's Banaras, for me, seemed to be a city which represented what maybe India civilizationally might have gone through. So when you look at the squalor and the filth, for me it wasn't necessarily a sign of squalor and filth, but it was a sign of a wounded civilization, as V.S. Naipaul might have said. In the sense, the city had gone through so much. It has been razed to the ground supposedly 13 times. It's been supposedly, I'm not sure, but the fact that it survived so much over so long, and we are still around, you know, that struck me as being very powerful.
Now, if this is all very relevant questions that people are talking about today and are revisiting today because of the new political dispensation in India. And as like I said earlier, what's happening even at this Lit Fest is that some of these questions are being revisited with slightly less irony and I think less subtlety than they do in the book. So this is a, it's a kind of question that sometimes authors hate to answer, but invariably they have to answer, which is to what extent did you find yourself responding to the modern political moment while coming up with this character and his antics?
So I have a very left-oriented friend and I have a very, very, very right-oriented friend who chatted with me about the book. So the left guy came up to me and said, you know, Ryan, I have something to say to you. And I'm saying, oh God, he's going to be, say something horrible. And he said, you've really showed it to those right-wing bastards. So I said, oh, okay, thank you. And a week later, the right-wing guy came up to me and called me and said, you know, you've really given them the finger. I said, who? He said, those left-wing guys. So in some regards, left-wing, right-wing, as far as I'm concerned, they both belong to the same vulture. And as far as Iyer is concerned, it concerns him, given that he's an old man, insofar as that he's concerned that that vulture is going to land. That's about it.
Okay. I talked about the visual detail earlier and the kind of the care that you've put into drawing out not just Banaras, but the landscape all the way up the Ganga to Allahabad and so on. The corollary to that is the world through which Mr. Iyer and his loyal companion, Bencho, I'm not sure how exactly I'm meant to pronounce that and how I'm allowed
right.
to pronounce
Bencho's
it.
Correct. But, it's everyone's nickname in Varanasi.
Is it? Yeah, right. So they're traveling through this landscape, which you can see very clearly, but they're also traveling courtesy of Mr. Iyer's preoccupations. They're traveling through a landscape of mythic concerns and philosophical questions. And a lot of the conversation that goes on between them has to do with Bencho wrestling with keeping Iyer alive and getting them to their destination, while Iyer sort of reels through the kind of celestial questions that concern him personally and that are driving him. So this is very interesting. It was very interesting for me. You know, you're a Bangalore Catholic boy. I was born into a Brahmin family. I didn't know. I couldn't have come up with any of
family
these philosophical
secret, so was
debates.
I, but anyway.
Ah, interesting. So I couldn't have explored these debates myself because I have never had that that education. You must have done a fair amount. I'm curious about what kind of research you did or what kind of exploration you did in order to be able to delve into the questions of Hindu philosophy via Mr. Iyer. And some of it is mumbo jumbo. Some of it is truly sort of profound. What is the balance of those two for you? Were you mimicking the kind of maundering of some sort of confused philosophers, or were you actually expressing through Iyer problems that you think Indian philosophy actually treats really well?
So in some regards, on this trip down the river Ganges, like you rightly said, it's a metaphor. So I like Conrad, and going down the river to the so-called heart, to the confluence, to the final conclusion, and they have these discussions along the way. So during my reading of Cervantes, especially about his life, I mean, nowadays we don't have the long speech. We don't have the person expounding forth and allowing to finish what he has to say over four pages. Now we have like three sentences and your editor will say, hey, can you make it two, you know? So you're right. In the sense, rambling, I feel, is sometimes needed to reach a certain conclusion. And for Iyer, where he travels down the very polluted Ganges, it's very sacred, yet it's very polluted. And he bemoans the state of what the world has come to. He bemoans the pollution. He's upset at the new myth, if you will, that's coming, which is consumerism, which is a very defined sort of capitalism. And his sidekick, his friend, Bencho, is a man who wants to become a politician and he wants to make money, and it's very simple. He's your everyman. So the conversations I felt were very necessary in the sense to have a man who steeped in his own myth, who believes, who are steeped in a certain belief system or way of looking, having a conversation with somebody who lives in today's world.
But you must have had to have some of these conversations with yourself before those conversations could become rendered as conversations between Mr. Iyer and Bencho trying to steer through waterfalls on the Ganga. What the essence of Mr. Iyer's philosophy is, of course, the Gita, unsurprisingly. Did you spend any time, some time reading the Gita and all of these other, you know, these hymns
But to be honest, my knowledge is not very deep, and it's based on just reading certain translations. And I found a lot of it very moving. I read Joseph Campbell, which the comparative mythologist, and I read Anand Kumaraswamy and his papers on sculpture, which I found pretty beautiful and evocative, as well as a whole bunch of other people who wrote papers, but not from contemporary times.
What about Rajiv Malhotra?
No, not yet. But stuff mostly from the 20s, actually. Older papers, and because I wanted an older way of looking. I didn't want a more postmodern way of looking at these belief systems. I wanted people steeped in their own faith and what they felt about these sculptures, because that was Iyer. So I chose Kumaraswamy.
So you're not going to be back here next year on a panel with Gurcharan Das to talk about the essentials of Indian philosophy and how they can make your photography better.
No, definitely not.
Now, this book is a sort of unusual book, and I keep coming back to how it seems informed by your background as a filmmaker. Another way, apart from its visual detail, is that it's full of action. Like, it's constantly in motion. And this is not unlike Don Quixote, the original. It's been a while since I spent any time with it, but they're always on the move. He's always getting knocked onto his rear and getting back up. And he's always sort of being humiliated.
Yes.
The pratfalls that Mr. Iyer constantly runs into, why do you think that? I'm trying to grasp why Iyer had to be. How come it's such a book so filled with action? It's not what you would expect from a book that is about these interior journeys. It actually works out very beautifully in terms of the balance between the physical action in the real world, and the somewhat loony journeys he makes in his mind.
Okay. So I've made films on the Ganges. I've spent a lot of time at the Kumbh, and it's constant action. I mean, you've got 60 million people in a few square kilometers. You can't avoid it. But at the same time, I get what you're saying. I was following structure loosely. So I was following monomythic structure and loosely inspired by Cervantes and Quixote. So I also didn't want to spend too much time on, like I was saying earlier, the long speeches and so on and so forth. And I also feel, in hindsight, that some of it was visually thought out. Not in the sense I was seeing it more as in my mind's eye, rather than as long speeches. So once again, readers, if you read it, hopefully the descriptions add to the philosophical intent.
Very much so. Now, I'm not sure if we're supposed to be doing any Q&A in this session. We have a few minutes. If anyone does have a question, please put your hand up. There's one over there.
Do you need a mic? Yeah, okay, thanks.
So my question is with respect to how did your filmmaking background help out with your writing? I mean, two things were mentioned. One was the extreme visualistic style that you went for, as well as the multitude of actions that you include in this particular book. But other than these two, did any aspect of storytelling in the filmmaking narrative help out while writing the book?
Well, I initially started off writing this as notes for a screenplay, for a feature film, and that slowly morphed into something else. But my filmmaking life certainly informed the film, in the sense I spent a lot of time in UP, on the Ganges, making films. So it certainly informed it, for sure. Yeah. I also used Campbellian structure while writing the book. which is film structure, basically.
I think a better question is, how come you write so well? It's a little bit annoying to those of us who are who spent a lot of time practicing. And there's so many sentences that I could have picked out. We would have wanted Ryan to do a reading, but this is a very short session, so we thought we'd keep it conversational.
Thank you, Raghu. Well, I'm flattered that you say that, absolutely. But I don't know. I think the act of writing... Well, you're always... when you write, you end up being much smarter than you are, because you can always edit it, you know? And then you can be inspired by some other writer and slip in a sentence here and there. So I think the act of writing makes you much smarter than you actually are, always.
I think that's true. Do we have any other questions?
The bald guy in the white shirt. Yeah, right here, third row. Third. No, no, no? Okay. That's my brother, anyway. Okay. Okay. Thank you, everybody. Go buy the book. Go buy it. I'll sign it for you all. Twice, if you all want to.
It's a wonderful book, and I really think that it's going to make a real impression on Indian fiction, and it's not one that you're going to want to miss. Thanks, all.
Thank you, Raghu. Thank you so much.